Welcome to Real Possibilities with AARP Connecticut. Because AARP believes no one's possibilities should ever be limited as they age. Hi, I'm Elaine Werner. I am your host for today's program. And we are coming to you in your local community. Today's show is going to focus on tips to prevent and protect fraud. Did you know that every 2 seconds, someone's identity is stolen? And that has impacted more than 15 million Americans, translating into billions of lost dollars for that type of scam and others. So the title of our program today is The Con Artist Playbook, Outsmarting the Scammers. And I'm gonna get right to my guests, two people that have been very close to a very important program with AARP called the AARP Fraud Watch Network. First, I'd like to introduce Erica Michalowski. Welcome, Erica.
Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. Erica is Director of Community Outreach on staff with the AARP nonprofit statewide office. And Erica goes now a couple years back easily in helping to launch, along with her key volunteer team, the AARP Fraud Watch Network. And Byron Peterson, her partner in preventing crime and fraud, is here with us today too. Byron has been a volunteer for many years. We thank you for that in multiple capacities, but a priority capacity has certainly been being a lead on the Fraud Watch Network. So I always like to bring the experts onto the show, and hopefully you can have some great takeaways to, again, protect your hard-earned income. So Erica, if you can just speak to our audience first a little bit about the Fraud Watch Network, why it started, and why AARP got involved.
Sure, I'm happy to. So AARP has always been committed to making sure that people are financially resilient and solvent, and you can't do that if your money is being taken away from you.
Absolutely.
So this was a nationwide launch back in 2013 in November. I remember that very vividly. The following year, we decided that Connecticut was going to embrace this. Byron became my crime fighter partner here, leading our amazing team of volunteers. And really, it was looking at consumer fraud protection across the board, online, on the ground, in your home, paying your bills, in the mail, you name it, we were going to cover it, and we were going to do this as a team.
Excellent. And I know that you've had some collaboration, or I believe you do, with other partner organizations. Why other organizations, and what role do they play?
Sure. So you can't do it alone. Right. This takes everybody to really try to fight these scammers who are making this their full-time job. Yeah. They don't have a conscience. They have no empathy for what they're actually doing and impacting lives in such a negative way. So we knew that if we were going to be able to do this, we needed our wonderful volunteer team. We have such a strong team, over 45 volunteers across the whole state. But we also found that law enforcement was looking to us. Why? Because peer-to-peer education works. We found that when this was started, it was actually Doug Shadell in our AARP Washington State office. He did a study with the Department of Justice a few years back before we started the Fraud Watch program, and found that there was a 50% reduction in the incidence of people being scammed again if they talk to a peer.
Excellent point.
Yeah. So we just leaned into that.
Mm-hmm.
And we did this in collaboration with the International Association of Financial Crimes Investigators, which spans the gamut of financial institutions to the United States Postal Inspectors to local law enforcement, the Treasury Department, the list goes on and on. And so we think of ourselves in Connecticut as one team. We go out, we do this work together, we share information, we share stories about what we're actually hearing on the ground and preventing it from happening in other parts of the country. We are leading the way for a collaborative approach. The Coalition for Elder Justice in Connecticut was an entity that we had belonged to before we even began our launch of the Fraud Watch project. And so they embraced it wholeheartedly and they said, AARP, can you lead our consumer fraud?
Cool.
And we said, sure, we'd be happy to.
Excellent. So collaboration, an incident happens, make sure you share it with others.
Mm-hmm.
And working in tandem, of course, with the great 40 plus volunteer team.
Yes.
Really, really great effort there. Byron, of course, I would think our viewer might know about, you know, you get a phone call, whether it's on your landline, whether it's on your cell phone. You see if you have caller ID, you see an area code that doesn't look quite right. And first couple times you may pick up the phone and something really doesn't seem right. But so that might be one that many people are familiar with, I'm guessing. But could you just briefly go through sort of the laundry list of different types of scams? We're going to get into a couple a little more in depth. But just, I know when I first started getting up to speed with the Fraud Watch Network, I didn't even think about some of these things, and now I'm sharing it. So let's share it with
you. Well, let's start with what you mentioned first, was phone. People will get a phone call, they'll look, and many times it's a number they don't recognize. But out of curiosity, you want to answer it, out of politeness, you want to answer it. And next thing you know, you've got someone on the line who is either threatening you or offering you what you can't believe be the greatest opportunity in the world. And it's usually someone who's an imposter, proclaiming themselves to be, we'll say, a Microsoft corporation, an individual, and your computer is having a problem. And we need to get into it because, I say this jokingly, you're going to shut down the Northeast Corridor because you have a virus. And it gets you excited. And they start asking you questions and take over your computer. So the phone call is one way that they can get you excited. Another way is through technology. You'll be on your email, and all of a sudden you get an email, what appears to be from your bank, a message that says, by the way, there's something wrong with your account. Please take this link, follow directions, give us information just to confirm your account number, and we should be okay. And it looks innocent, sounds innocent, but next thing you know, you've just given away some personal information, allowing someone to do what is basically the most difficult and most largest type of scam, identity theft. They try to take your personal information and take that away. They use it either to clean out your bank account, possibly, or to create new credit cards, create new bank cards, new loans. Suddenly, your numbers are out there elsewhere and someone is using it. So that's another thing they look at. But there's other things. Seasonally, you're at home. Someone knocks on the door. Hi, I'm in the neighborhood, and your neighbor and I just finished doing some work on the siding of your house, or their house. Yours looks a little warm. Would you care if we gave you a quote, maybe, and get you into a conversation? And you might say, yeah, I'll sign a contract and give them a down payment. And you may never see one, that check again, or that individual. So that's another way to do it. But I also say that lotteries, we've heard about them. We don't believe it, but they still go on. Suddenly, I can simply think that I've been a victim at one time. I became a millionaire shortly after I took over.
This is the first time hearing of this.
I was a millionaire. I won the Publishers Clearinghouse Lottery. I danced around that kitchen with my feet
Were
above the
vision.
Floor. And then Logic, otherwise known as my wife, started asking questions.
Listen,
did you do this?
Spouse.
Did you do this? Did you do this? And suddenly that $1 million just went like this. But it gave me an example and understanding of how people can react and think that they've got something they really don't have and do something that's not necessarily sensible. And that's what these commerce look forward to.
And one other that I want, there's so much to talk about in these scams, and the scammers are always one step ahead of us, unfortunately. But I don't want to forget to mention debit cards versus credit cards.
Yes. We strongly suggest people always use credit cards, not debit cards. The reason for that is many times you have more protections using a credit card opportunity of recovering or stopping payments versus if it's your debit card and they get into it and you don't find out in time, they can clean out your account.
Got it.
So that's
okay. If there's one takeaway, that's one right there. Now, I've heard of something that's been prevalent. It's called romance scams, where people steal your heart, and guess what? They can also steal your cash. So, Erica, we're going to put up on the screen some of the warning signs of what a romance scam is. Can you tell our viewer what that is and what are the warning signs of that, please?
Sure. And I have to say, I want to point out that any scam where Byron was just giving you a sense of him winning that $1 million, it's a heightened emotional state that you feel. It's this feeling as though you're in love. So think about the romance scam. Somebody wanting to fall in love with you. It's a wonderful feeling. So one of the warning signs is that somebody wants to leave where you're dating, having a date, immediately. They may find that they're asking a lot of information and not giving a lot of information back. Some other things that can happen is they may say they live one place and they live actually in another place. Mm. So it's, if something doesn't feel right, you know, pay attention to your gut. You're probably going to be right about it. And we find too that when somebody is feeling as though they're lonely, they've been through a very life-altering event like a divorce or a death of a spouse or a child, anything, a move, you become more vulnerable. In fact, AARP did a study. I don't know, I believe you have a graphic on that
yeah,
as well.
Yeah, it's some key Connecticut findings, if you can address that
yes,
as well. Yeah.
Yes, about 70, almost 80% of the victims that were interviewed had been affected by a life-altering event. Mm. So they become that vulnerable person that mm-hmm. is going to have the feeling of that ether, that heightened emotional state, even more widely spread. When we go out and we do these presentations and Byron's team, they've been doing them across the state, we're finding that romance scams is really coming up. Mm-hmm. Online, mm-hmm. in person, we had an incident, I don't know if you wanted to share the story of when you were doing a workshop. What happened after the workshop? That's usually what happens, right. More information mm-hmm. after the workshop. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Usually, yeah, as she said, it happens after the workshop. This is one case in which I had a probate judge with me, and we were going through it. And I usually talk about the different scams, and I happen to mention the last one being a romance scam. Mm-hmm. And I hear off to my left kind of a, and suddenly this woman stood up, and she started asking the judge pointed questions, specifically like, why aren't you able to arrest these individuals who are recipients of money because of romance scams? And his answer threw her. He said, basically, if you're giving that away, that's not a crime. You're giving them mm-hmm. that money. It's not a crime. And occasionally, I pop a question I did this time. I said, do you have a story? And she said, yes. And she walked to me to give me the story, and she collapsed my arms and said, I'm a victim of a romance scam, and I just discovered it this morning. I gave this individual $60,000,
my
life savings, and it's gone. I can't do it. And I'm standing here in front of an audience of 60-plus people, and the judge was there, and he said, let us help you. And we took her aside. And that's just one example of a person's life. And everybody suddenly realized, this is real. A romance scam can happen.
Well, you it's a good segue right there, Byron. Let me just repeat, though, again, you can have the euphoria of winning money,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
or
mm-hmm.
you can be in a vulnerable and maybe a little more desperate or isolated, lonely situation, and somebody's offering you something that's going to uplift you.
And asking for something in return.
Right.
The money is the piece.
Yes,
that is
right.
One of the
yes.
things, if they begin to ask you for money,
right?
Even
mm-hmm.
if it's $5 to $50, it just begins that way. Mm-hmm. Subtle.
So on that note, AARP Connecticut's Fraud Watch Network has developed presentation programs throughout
yes.
the state.
Yes.
We're again a statewide nonprofit side of AARP. And Byron, you have been a leader in this. You've helped train people. In mm-hmm. fact, Byron may be a familiar face to you. You may have seen him in the community, or you will. But Byron, if you can tell our viewer a little bit about what would they expect in a Fraud Watch presentation.
Well, first let me indicate to people that it's an interaction between the audience and the speaker. We don't just stand like a teacher in front and present. Mm-hmm. We talk to everybody, we share information. We provide information that hopefully people can take back and use it, first identify it as a tool of how to understand the criminal's mind. You know, we have the con artist thinking. We basically teach them these are the different aspects and approaches that the con artist will take to get you excited to make a decision that's not necessarily in your favor. And then we share that with people, and we talk a lot about it. We do tell stories. That's mm-hmm. a very poignant feature. People. One thing we found out is most of my presenters are mature members of the population, I would say, seniors, right? And people are able to relate with them, and we start sharing, and they'll start sharing.
Mm-hmm.
And suddenly it becomes a conversational meeting instead of just back and forth or the one-way direction. So we do that. We provide them with booklets at times to take home and say, this is a reminder to reinforce what we've talked about. But I say the biggest message is at the end, we always say to them, share this message, what you've learned. Share with family, share with your neighbors, share with your loved ones so they hear it as well. And we've had feedback that came back, gee, I heard from so-and-so, and that saved me from making a mistake. So that's basically, in a nutshell, what we try to do in a presentation.
And I understand that people are really knocking down our doors to have these presentations brought to their communities, because this impacts everybody. And by the way, you know, we're AARP, our membership is 50 and older, but the information that we're imparting today is really for any age person. But Erica, if somebody watching wants to bring this program into their community, how do they hook up with us to do that?
Sure. Well, they can contact me directly, Erica Michalowski. I give out my telephone number directly, 860-548-3163. If I'm not there, I'm having fun with this guy over here out in the community. But we do this in English and Spanish and for bilingual audiences. So this is something that is very important. The more vulnerable you are to a situation, the easier it is to be scammed. So language can be a barrier to somebody. And also, it can also become, they can become a target, which is very scary. So we love to do these workshops in any venue. We go to libraries, we go to private groups. You've done quite a few for private groups asking us to come in. Yeah. And so has the team. We've been doing this all around the state. And it's one of those things where probably we do between, I used to say 8 to 10, it's about 10 to 15 workshops in a month during our busy season. We give everyone the month of January off and the month of December, but we do need more volunteers. But we also want to get the information out there. We bring in our issue experts that I mentioned before, the Department of Consumer Protection and Department of Banking, along with other law enforcement entities, come out and they do this with us. We do our presentation, but sometimes there's those questions. We're not the issue experts. We give the information out. And so if you are in trouble or if you feel you've been a victim, one way is to get help right in our workshop, and we'll connect to who to contact if you've been a victim.
That's a fabulous thing to know. And I'm the program specialist for volunteer engagement with AARP. Erica and I are colleagues on staff in the office. Again, Byron Peterson, our volunteer lead for the Fraud Watch Network. And if you are interested in volunteering with the Fraud Watch program, I'm going to give you my direct number, Elaine Warner, 860-548-3169. Information will be up on the screen, including my email. But let's just quickly address, if somebody is interested in volunteering, you're the volunteer, the lead. What kind of role do they play as a volunteer in the Fraud Watch Network?
Well, what they do is they learn the basic message that we try to get out. It's one constant message, and that is to give people information that will allow them to identify a con artist and protect themselves and their loved ones. And then we teach them techniques of how to get that out, how to present it, how to share it. One thing we let everybody know is, although they look at us as experts, we're not experts. We're really facilitators of a conversation, and that's how we do it. We bring them in, we train each other, and then on a quarterly basis, we as a team get together to kind of share what's happening, what's the feedback, here's some new things, and we bring in our partners to help us as well. So it's a good involvement. It's a great way to give back to the community and help others to protect themselves.
Great. And if you want to go to any of our presentations, again, you can call me directly, Elaine Warner. AARP.org/CT, you're going to see something called events. You can click on it, register for it. But again, feel free to call me. I'm happy to elaborate on our program. You know, I have to mention, Erica and Byron, I remember years ago there was a movie, Catch Me If You Can. Mm-hmm. Perhaps you have seen it. There was a real person who was a scam artist globally as a very young man. And was it Leonardo DiCaprio played him in the movie?
Yes.
So, Erica, who was that person, and how is he taking his criminal expertise and applying it to help people prevent and protect themselves against fraud today with AARP?
Sure. So, Frank W. Abagnale, he is our AARP ambassador to the Fraud Watch Network program. Mm-hmm. And Byron and I have had the pleasure of meeting him and talking with him and seeing his amazing presentation A few times now. Yes. We saw him. Yes. So he was in Connecticut in 2017. We were at Central Connecticut State University. Yep. We had over 1,000 people there, okay. and we learned something new all the time. But he has these wonderful tips that he likes to share with people about protecting their information, specifically their social security number, their birth date, their credit card information, shredding everything that you possibly can using the crisscross ones, you know, there's all the different types, the cross cut. There's so much information to learn from him. And that information is on our AARP.org/fraudwatchnetwork. He has a whole area there. He also does podcasts from time to time that you can listen to. But we're also going to be having him back in Connecticut in 2019, in the eastern part of Connecticut in June. So we're very excited about that. And we're going to exceed our 1,000 attendees. But he is a person that embraces the work that Byron and his team does. When you become a volunteer with the AARP Fraud Watch Network, Byron has a core team of trainers, of master trainers, that mentor you throughout your whole process, because we do meet quarterly, because we need to keep up with what's happening and get out ahead of the scammers, get out ahead of the information. It's like whack-a-mole. You know, you hit one scam and you think you got it covered, and another one pops up, and then they actually come back around. Yes. The grandparent scam is notorious for that. That rears its ugly head every single year. That one in particular is where a person will call up and say that they're a person's grandchild, and then the person says, oh my goodness, and maybe they're in jail, maybe they've gotten arrested, and then they wire money. So that's just one to share. So Mr. Abagnale covers the gamut of everything that's happening, and he is one of those people that keeps up on all of this and helps to educate us. So a scammer turned
I like this
educator.
And you know, we mentioned isolation and euphoria as reasons to react to a scam. Unfortunately, fear is a big one for
huge.
Sure. Fear.
Huge. Yeah. Intimidation.
Yeah.
All and these kind of artists will do that. They'll get you frightened so that you can react to benefit them.
Now, on that note, if you can play, give some tips to our Connecticut audience, because are there scams that are specific to our state? I think you're aware of them.
There have been. In Connecticut, identity theft is one of the top ones. Imposter scams is number two. And then debt collection is a third one. And this was identified by the Federal Trade Commission, letting us know. They had, last year, somewhere around 21,000 reports that were given. And these are just reports that came to them. And in Connecticut, basically, it's about over $10 million just basically from those reports. So there's others that they haven't received. It's greater. But in Connecticut, there's a lot there that's coming up. The one I mentioned, the Social Security one, is increasing, surprisingly. The Federal Trade indicated that in 2017, they had 3,000 reports. And 2018, they had over 20,000 reports.
Wow.
Just on that alone. So it's gotten huge. We have people who made the most recent one, an imposter call where they were an IRS investigator. And they sent a letter out, and it said it threatened the individual with a due date and so forth, and a telephone number to call back and a link. Well, most people call back. And of course, the individual on the phone was all prepped and said, here's what you need to do.
Yep.
So those right now are the ones here in Connecticut that have popped up recently.
Well, thank you for that information. And Eric, if you could just mention, we're going to put this on the screen. If you know, if you are a victim of fraud, you know someone that's been a victim of fraud, where do they go with that information? What do you advise?
So if they're in Connecticut, of course, we will always talk to people. But if you want immediate help, and if you feel that you are actually in fear, if something is happening, always call your local law enforcement. But what you can do, if you're just not sure about a situation, you can talk to one of our peer educators across the whole country on the Fraud Watch Network, 1-877-908-3360. And I believe that phone number will be on the screen
Absolutely.
For everyone. They can also contact me again. My number is 860-548-3163. And you can also email me as well, emichalowski@aarp.org. And we are always there to help people, get them connected. We've helped so many people get to the right person to know who to call. So, but if you are scared, if something is happening, if you're just not sure, please call your local PD. Your local police department is there to help you, and they can help you navigate.
Yeah. And in another way, Byron, to if you can address the Fraud Watch alerts, because we say these criminals are steps ahead of us, mm-hmm. and we want to mm-hmm. outsmart them, the title of our program today. How does one sign up for an alert, and what is an alert?
Basically, if you join the Fraud Watch Network, you will get an alert to let you know what's happening in your area, what are the most frequent scams, and give you a chance to respond and say, hey, by the way, should you get a phone call, you can alert yourself and alert your neighbors.
And again, AARP.org/Fraud Watch Network, you could find a place to sign up there.
And it's free. You don't have to be a member of AARP. It's free.
Absolutely. I want to thank both of you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The knowledge. I always have good takeaways on this subject. I hope you do too. I want to thank you for watching. If you are one of the 600,000 plus members of AARP in Connecticut, we all want to thank you for that. And again, if you're interested in becoming a volunteer with AARP, with the Fraud Watch Network, or I can tell you about many other programs, please call me directly, Elaine Warner, volunteer specialist, engagement specialist, I should say. I want to engage you. 860-548-3169. We love coming to you in your local community. We hope you'll come back and see us. Stay tuned, and thanks for watching.